The basic challenge in accountancy is to understand or decode the debit or credit of the aspect correctly, because we know that debit and credit are the two pillars on which the total base of accountancy is standing. So if at the very initial level the accountant cannot decode this and this aspect of a transaction correctly, then finally the reports which will be generated by that data, by that accounting data, will be misstated or corrupted. So in this video we'll try to take different transactions as examples and try to decode the accounts involved for the debit aspect and the accounts involved for the credit aspect, and finally we'll try to post journal entries for the same. So let us take the problem. From the following, state the nature of accounts involved and how the accounts are to be debited or credited. So there is a list of some events which happened in a business, and by studying each event, each of them, we will have to decode the accounts involved and which account will be debited and which will be credited. So for this we are going to need these rules, that is the golden rules, and I'll discuss them. I have already made a video for which I'll leave a card in this video, and we will discuss these golden rules when we go through these examples. So let us come back to the problem. So the first one, Mr. X, he is the owner of the business, started business with capital by paying cash rupees 20,000. So Mr. X is a person who started a business and he invested cash as capital into the business by paying rupees 20,000. So let us see what happens in this transaction. Let us discuss the two aspects first. First, in this transaction, cash is coming into the business. And who is giving the cash? The owner or Mr. X is giving the cash in the form of capital. So Mr. X giving the cash. The owner's transactions with business is generally represented by the capital account. So the cash which is coming into the business is in the form of capital, which is contributed by the owner. So this capital account represents Mr. X. Now what is the amount? The amount is 20,000. Now you are pretty sure about the fact that cash is an asset. This is pretty obvious. Cash is an asset. And asset is coming in. So let us move to the rules now. So golden rule says, real accounts which consists of assets, so real accounts consists of assets and it is coming in, so it should be debited. A real account, if it comes in, then it should be debited. So in this case, cash is an asset which is coming into the business, so this will be the debit aspect. And who is giving this cash? The owner or Mr. X is giving this cash in the form of capital. So capital account is nothing but a representative account for Mr. X, who is the giver of the capital. So let us come back to the rules itself. We see personal account. For personal accounts, we consider all accounts of all persons, and here we credit the giver. For personal account, we have two classifications, so actual persons and representatives of persons. So capital account is the representative of the owner. So here the owner is the giver of the capital, so his account or the capital account will be credited. So the capital account of Mr. X will be credited. So let us now try to enter this transaction into the journal. This is the format of a journal. Here we write the date, then the particulars of the transactions involved, the ledger folio, we will talk about this later, amount of the debit aspect and amount of the credit aspect over here. These journal entries are being done in the books of the business of Mr. X. and the journal entries. So first we'll write the date over here. So let us assume that this transaction is happening on 1st January 2016. And at the first we write the debit accounts. So from the from this part we saw that the cash account which is coming into the business has to be debited because it is a real account, and real account if it comes into the business it has to be debited as per the rules. So first we will write here cash account, and then to signify that this account is being debited we write a small DR for debit, because DR is a short widely accepted short form of debit, and for credit the short form is CR. So for cash account, since it is debited, we will write cash account and then we'll write DR for debit, and we will write the amount over here which was 20,000. I guess it was 20,000, let me check. Yes, it was 20,000. So cash account debit 20,000, and for credit we do not write like capital account credit. Instead we prefix a 2, we prefix the word 2 before the accounts which are credited. So 2 capital account, and we generally omit this word CR for the credit aspect, because the prefix 2 already signifies that this account is being credited. So we do not need this CR and we omit to write it. So cash account debit to capital account, this 2 signifies that the capital account is being credited. It really seems weird that why we are using debit after the debit account but not using credit after the account which is being credited, and using 2 instead. It is a bit weird. It felt weird to me also at the first moment, but this is the style which has been followed for many years, and we will also follow the same style. So to capital account, and capital has been invested for rupees 20,000. We know the value for debit and credit aspect of a transaction is always equal. So cash account debit. Now comes a very important part of the journal entry, that is the narration. Narration contains a short description of the entry being made over here. So we will start a bracket over here and we'll write the narration, and the narration always begins with the word being. So we'll write being cash invested as capital. Narration is nothing but a one liner or very short description of the transaction that we are recording in the journal entry. So our first transaction is complete. This one is complete. Now let us come to the second one. Purchases goods from B and company on credit. Purchases goods from B and company on credit for rupees 8,000. So let us see what are happening in this transaction. We are purchasing goods on credit. So the thing which is coming in is goods, and goods are assets. So we saw that for any real account or an asset which is coming in, it should be debited. But we cannot write serially. The goods may be of different kinds and varieties, and we cannot write each good by say X commodity, Y commodity, Z commodity line by line in the journal, AX, Y, Z line by line in the journal. So we generalize the goods purchased by use of the purchase account. We use the purchase accounts for the goods purchased and sales account for the goods sold. So the goods purchase account will be proxy for the goods purchased, and in this case it will be debited, which I have already written here. One more way of thinking this aspect is, since purchase is an expense of the business, and when we see the rules, all expenses are under the nominal account and we debit all expenses and losses. So if you think of purchase account as an expense, then you could also think of it as an expense, and expense when incurred is to be debited. So the treatment will be the same, the point of view of looking to it becomes different. If you consider purchase as an asset because goods are coming in, then also it will be debited, and if you consider purchase as an expense, then also it will be debited. So there are different ways of decoding things into a transaction. So purchase account will be debited. And what will be credited over here? Let us see the problem. Purchase goods from B and company on credit for rupees 80,000. So we have purchased goods from B and company, but we have not paid any cash. We have purchased the goods on credit. So since, if we come to the rules, we see the giver of the goods, is a person. B and company is artificial person. B and company is an artificial person who is the giver of the goods. So B and company will be credited rupees 8,000. So now we will, let us try to enter the journal. Say we have done this on the same date. So we write purchase account, debit to B and company, since he is the giver of the goods to B and company, and the value is 8,000. 8,000 on both sides. So we'll have to write the narration over here. B goods purchased on credit. Now let us move to the next entry, which is, this has been done. Now this one is goods sold for cash rupees 7,000. So goods is being sold, sales is an income, and all incomes are credited. If you see the rules, incomes and gains fall under the nominal account, and we credit all incomes and gains. So sales is an income which should be credited. Or other way of thinking this aspect is, goods are moving out, when you sell things, the goods from your stock generally go out, and goods is an asset or a real account. So if we see the real rules for the real account, that credit was what goes out is to be credited. So same here, if you think from this aspect also, this will be credited. Cash, and cash is coming in for rupees 7,000. So cash being a real asset which is coming in, that is to be debited. Well, let us write the journal entry. The date, let us say it is on 2nd January 16. We are cash account debit, since cash is coming in for rupees 7,000 to sales account. The same concept, we are substituting the goods account with the sales account. 7,000. And here the narration would be being goods sold for cash. Now let us move to the next transaction in the problem, and I will try to increase my pace a bit. Purchased furniture for cash rupees 4,500. So in this case, furniture, which is being an asset, is coming in, and cash being an asset is going out. So debit what comes in, both are real accounts. Debit what comes in, credit what goes out. So furniture is coming in and cash is going out. So for furniture will be debited, since it is coming in, cash will be credited for rupees 4,500, since it is going out. So let us write the journal. 3rd January 16. Furniture is coming in. Furniture is being purchased. Furniture account debit, value was rupees 4,500 to cash account. This was 4,500, and the narration would be being furniture purchased for cash. I am not writing it anymore. Let us come to the next transaction. Sold goods to Mr. R for rupees 9,000. See, the here the problem gets a bit tricky. Sold goods to Mr. R for rupees 9,000, but it is not mentioned that whether it is sold for cash or credit. Here it is not mentioned that whether the goods are sold for cash and credit or credit. So where the name of the person to whom the goods are sold is mentioned, where the name of the person to whom the goods are sold is mentioned, but it is not mentioned whether it is sold on cash or credit, then we will always assume that it is sold on credit. It is a credit sale, not a cash sale. Otherwise, if the name of the person is mentioned and it is specifically mentioned that the sales was made on cash, then only we are going to assume that it was a cash sale. Otherwise, we will always assume that it was a credit sale. So for journal, we will write sold goods to Mr. R for rupees 9000. So we will write Mr. R is the receiver of the goods. 4116. Mr. R is the receiver of goods, so we have R account. Mr. R's account in our books will be debited since he is the receiver. Let me show you the rules again. For every personal account, since Mr. R is a person, his account will be debited since he is the receiver of the goods. So R account debit 9000 to sales account. Since we have sold the goods, we are going to credit the sales account. Credit all incomes and gains. Nominal account rules. Credit all incomes and gains. So since sales is an income, we are going to credit the sales account. Here we will have to write the narration. Being goods sold on credit to Mr. R. I am not writing it. Let us see the next one. Purchased goods from Mr. S and company on cash. Since it is specifically mentioned that we have purchased these goods on cash, there is no doubt that we have purchased it on cash. But say this on cash word was omitted and it was only written purchased goods from S and company for rupees 8000, then we would have assumed that this purchase is on credit basis, that is, it is a credit purchase. So let us do the journal entry. First let us discuss. Since we are purchasing the goods, purchase account, purchase is an expenditure and all expenses and losses are to be debited as per the rules for the nominal account. So we will debit the purchase account, and since cash is a real asset which is moving out, debit what comes in and credit what goes out. So cash will be credited and purchase account will be debited. Let us write the journal. Say it happened on the same day, 4116. Purchase account debit to cash account with 8000 to cash account 8000, and we have to write the narration. Being goods purchased on cash. Now let us move to the next. Opened a bank account and deposited rupees 6000 there. So what is happening in this transaction? You are opening a bank account. A bank account is a place where your cash is being deposited. So bank account, a representation of your cash being kept with the bank. So it is also an asset. Bank account is an asset. When you open a bank account and deposited cash over there, the value of the asset is increasing by the amount you deposit over there. And when you open a bank account and deposit money over there, your cash balance is decreasing. So here in this transaction, the value of the bank account is increasing and your cash account is falling, because you are sending this cash into the bank and both are by rupees 6000. So since both are real assets, money comes into your bank is a real asset, so it will be debited, and cash is going out, real account, for what goes out you need to credit, so it will be credited. So the journal entry will be bank account debit to cash account. Say it happened on 5116. Entry will be bank account debit to cash account, and this is for rupees 6000, and the narration will be being cash deposited into bank. Now let us move a bit to the next one. See this one. Collected the passbook from bank by sending a messenger. When you open an account with the bank gives you a passbook. So Mr. X sent a messenger to the bank to collect the passbook. So how will this transaction be recorded? Any ideas? If you see clearly, this transaction does not involve a monetary value. And in the money measurement concept, we had learned that any transaction or event, any event that happens in the business which cannot be measured in terms of money is not to be recorded in accounts. So since the collection of the passbook from the bank does not have any monetary involvement, this entry will not be recorded in accounts. So there will be no journal entry for this. No journal entry. Now let us come to the next and last one. Paid rent for the office ₹1200. You have paid rent for the office ₹1200. Rent is an expense. Rent is an expense. And when expenses are incurred, as per the rules, when expenses are incurred, you have to debit them. Debit all expenses and losses. So rent is an expense. So rent in this case will be debited. And since you are paying the rent, cash is moving out. Cash is moving out. So cash being a real asset, cash being a real asset is to be credited, because what goes out in case of real account or assets is to be credited. So we will write the journal as, say the date is 6th January 2016. We will write the journal as rent, which is an expense. Rent will be debited. All expenses and losses are debited. Rent account debit ₹1200 to cash account ₹1200. And we will write the narration as, let me write this one, being rent paid. So this was all about you may say this was a small example to demonstrate how to decode events or transactions of a business into the debit and credit aspect and how to post them in the journal. So we have posted all these entries into the journal one by one. I know it was a long video. If you understood it, if you liked it, please give it a thumbs up. And if you are not subscribed to my channel, please do so, because I will be bringing similar kind of videos in the future also. Thanks for watching.